Okay, I am sorry, to all of you, but I have to talk about the artistic cruelties of Facebook and Facebook. Do it now, or later. Okay, later, then I will bring out another, conventional artistic political connection, but first I have to talk about the more practical bond between your world and the studio of Peter Klaashorst, way back in Southeast Asia. Of course, I cannot evade a sort of a Facebook perspective, but as I said, later. The geographical distance between Peter Klaashorst's workspace and the reception of a part of his public, here in Europe, is responsible for his use of Facebook. And it is easy to sum up the advantages this medium gives an artist in his position. He can now experience how it feels to have world ambition, and at the same time to see different local communities react to different parts of it. That is the Facebook dilemma, never sure where is your point of view. Local or global? That is a challenge in which Peter Klaashorst excels. This is a challenge, I said, but perhaps it is also a dilemma. And I am not sure in which paintings we can experience this as a dilemma, and in which it is a challenge. And then, in his whole career there was always this unexpected feeling of what his paintings want.
We are live from my backyard, where I am smoking a brisket and some ribs. It's all about form, right? So I don't have the form down yet. And we're all right. We're back.
Reunie. Reunie in de ruis als dat
zal het. Grill talk.
Yeah.
We have just applied the Sweet Baby Ray's to the ribs.
Local or global?
Maar we mogen er niet meenemen. Ik het ook.
Nee, ik heb, ja, er is eentje voor jou. Ja. Verraden. Nee, de verraden, ik slaap nooit, zei
Karel. Wij doen ook maar wat.
Wat?
Ja. Wij doen ook maar
wat. Ja, wij doen maar wat.
Je bent een heel intelligent verhaal. Dus, over Mark Zuckerberg.
Ja, nee. Dit is over je verhaal.
Dit is mooi. Beter vergeten mee. Ja.
Ik zal voorlezen uit eigen werk.
Is dat van de...
We're all gonna die, so
Mark Zuckerberg.
This tension between the work and the world, real and or elusive, was the urgent question when, some decades ago, the so-called postmodern experience of history was debated. Everywhere you heard the question, if this is not the truth, how can we face the something that seems to be the truth? But these are, in our eyes now, only decadent questions, or, at least, questions that have no urgency now. That is a reality for a painter of the quality of Peter Klaashorst, who gave in an earlier period, living in Cambodia, new life to the faces of Red Khmer victims of the 70s. Later I come back to these portraits. When exploring an existential, ethical issue like this, these above mentioned, aesthetical questions had for him no credibility anymore. The Red Khmer issue gave Peter Klaashorst a legitimate excuse to evade all these contemporaneous postmodern and more recent artistic discussions. It is a legitimate excuse for him to evade the relevance of this proposition, and to forget all postmodern reconstruction of this pre-postmodern ways of working. And this is no surprise for us. Remember, how, in a much older documentary, we see the artist in his studio, making a portrait of a fellow artist. In a sense, his work then feels more as the result of a 17th century painting production. We feel the connection between this documentary and earlier historical movies about famous painters, like Rembrandt. The cliché of a searching and scrupulous observing artist, the posing of the sitter, the whole atmosphere of the studio, all are in a good harmony to let the artist get his real concentration. Of course, Peter Klaashorst is breaking open this atmosphere with all kind of destructive gestures, but in essence, we, as public, still feel our emotional participation in this conventional ritual. This is the portrait that Peter Klaashorst likes the best, as we know from his literary work. Peter Klaashorst is also an author of Don Quixote, like adventures. He has an incredible ability in writing about his artistic adventures, in which he succeeds in getting a good balance and a perfect timing to let the reader never stop this lecture. In his writings, Peter Klaashorst is at least as versatile as possible.
Ben maximaal geknipperd, hoor.
Ja,
ik vind het wel een bakker.
Een bakker? Een
bakker. In his writings, Peter Klaashorst is at least as versatile and spontaneous and fast as in his painting gestures. He has a perfect intuition and eye for the significant detail, and he can produce his anecdotes as a professional entertainer. Here we see how Klaashorst, as an artist of pure painter, can in his personal lifestyle be more like a public entertainer. And, as I discovered there, he is a good didactical master. Take a look at the clip on YouTube, The New Rabonic Slash, in which I show how the painting lessons of Peter Klaashorst influenced the mastery of camera work that made Rabonic TV in the 80s so infamous. The own identity of Rabonic TV was centered around the ideal good mental montage. And, as you can see in the clip, just follow the prescripts of Peter Klaashorst and you are a part of a master class on cinematographic subtlety. That is, cinematography that has its roots in the tradition of the portrait painting of the 17th century. Because, how much avant-garde Peter Klaashorst perhaps radiates, in his heart he is an old-fashioned portrait painter. And you can easily verify that in his new work he is too. But, of course, there is a new element in his recent work. It is as if he uses an incredible cosmopolitan-looking glass, a kind of kaleidoscopically character for his work. Of course, this is a metaphor for what I feel is the influence of Facebook in his work. Sometimes, as I said, Peter Klaashorst uses the old vulgar and iconographic images we all know, or his generation seems to think are part of an old tradition. But then the new images he uses have another imprint, a characterization that is not easy to grasp. Perhaps, it is the idea of mental montage that gives a clue to the artistic secret of this painter. Mental montage, a concept taken from the film world, in which the cameraman uses the moment of filming also as an opportunity to do the montage, avoiding the after-filming cutting. To spare time, spare money, and spare concentration. No, yes, sorry, I have to come back to Mark Zuckerberg. Because to our surprise, it is Master Mark Zuckerberg who is the real image builder of Klaashorst. So, no surprise, that Peter Klaashorst has an ambiguous relation with this master of the universe. This kind of relation is a strange phenomenon. We know it from the Renaissance, when writer Giorgio Vasari immortalized in his chronicles the names of the grand masters of this period. And we know it because later the German art historian Winckelmann, nearly literary, took the colored clothes from the old Greek and Roman statues and declared them as pure white and clean. We know it from Clement Greenberg, who exercised a dubious critical influence on the New York abstract geometric painters. It is the turn of Mark Zuckerberg to dictate the outcome of the world of painters as Klaashorst. Of course, Peter Klaashorst revels in a clash against this crazy intervention, or, to say it more gently, they two still are in debate about who will be the real artistic messenger. As a result, we have a portrait of Mark of Peter Klaashorst's hand, and, I ask you, can we find some traces of this duel here? I do not think so.
You ever end up seeing the film, the social network?
Yeah, I did.
Cool. Oh, thanks. What did you think?
It was interesting.
Because I never trapped Peter Klaashorst on resentment. So when he takes Mark, the self-chosen master of the new digital world, as a painterly subject, it is still in the guise of a painter's model.
Jij kent me niet meer.
Ja, maar nee, even niet.
Ja, maar. Hey Paula, jij kent je niet meer. Hij herkent mij niet meer.
Nou, je bent wel gekomen. Hey, tot ziens, hè.
Oké. Okay.
Nou, hey, dat is goed. Nou, dat is goed. Leuk.
Ik zit voor Robotnik TV.
Hé, hey, druk die Oh ja, meteen.
But I, myself, I feel much more anger against Zuckerberg. I do not believe any more in his act of innocence, or naivety. I am convinced he is a real conscious man, engaged in an incredible criminal act. Or is stealing all our personal identities and secrets for a commercial destination not a criminal act? And what can a painter do with this mark? Satirize him, characterize him, makes jokes about him, or stay cool and let him be his own self. Peter Klasvorst does kind of respect him, as if he realizes that Mark, as his double, really participates in his paintings. So, when I write about Peter Klasvorst's work, of course I cannot evade the daily discipline of the Facebook regime that dominates my knowledge of his later work. There have been times that I, so to say, visited his studio day by day, but now it is a regular Facebook contact that provides my information about him. Small, post-stamp-like miniatures tell me about his small paintings, but also about his huge work. But they all share, of course, the radiating sunny atmosphere in which our friend, Facebook founder Mark Zuckerberg, transforms all our information exchange into some kind of fine, short sound bites and miniature images. So, when I speak here about the work of my friend Peter Klasvorst, you must understand that I am talking about the fantasy figures that Peter Klasvorst images are transformed to, thanks to the design of Facebook. I am sure that Peter Klasvorst can appreciate this intervention. Although he is not a practical joker, he will applaud the tricks that let the public believe that he can practice the incredible commercial tactics that Zuckerberg specializes in. We knew that Peter Klasvorst has always been the painter of a tricky world that emanates not only from his happy dreams but also from his scary nightmares. But that Zuckerberg has the ability to present his work as only part of his happy dream.
Je hebt tegenwoordig een camera.
Nee, dat ben ik zelf. Als,
Jij bent de camera. In de camera monteer.
Dreams. This is a therapeutic intervention, or, better, an artistic trick that must help the public to better understand Peter Klasvorst's world by optimizing it. Let it be. But the fact that Zuckerberg also censored Klasvorst's artistic production by excluding him more than once for a certain period from Facebook and so forcing him to soften his artistic practice to the rules of Zuckerberg, is of course another thing. Here we see how the daily practice of Zuckerberg works out when you will not follow his commands. His world is based on the silent agreement that he can take all from us, because he sees us as a kind of naive consumers. And he is not ashamed to use his Facebook to take as much information as he can get. He is not like an ordinary pickpocket that tries to steal your purse, and if not your purse, some paper money will do. And after he got it, he disappears. No, Zuckerberg wants all of you, your body and your mind, and as a little supplement your purse. And that not only once, but day after day, hour after hour, second after second, millisecond after millisecond. In the end, he only will be happy if he can control your breath, your mind, and your heartbeat. Never the world has seen on such a huge scale such a totalitarian digital attack on humankind. If you call the mafia a criminal organization, you can imagine how I call Zuckerberg's organization. Or, is taking away our personal data, minute after minute, and selling it to the highest bidder not a criminal act? If feels, he steals consciously our personal to deliver them to all kinds of known and unknown forces in our world. And if you, as Peter Klasvorst did, protest against this regime by attacking him in his weak Achilles heel, by using the sexual apparatus, he tries to silence you. Even if you, as Peter Klasvorst did, do this on a very modest way and only show some sexual excitement, you are guilty of endangering the reign of Zuckerberg. and you must be beaten and silenced. But, engaging in this struggle between an artist and a world conglomerate, does Peter Klaashorst realize, at the same time, that Mark is not only an antagonist, but also a companion of himself? That the quality of his work is an illustration of the quality of the Facebook culture? This antagonism, this double-faced opposition, makes Klaashorst's new work really actual and contemporary. And therefore, so to say, his work is better than ever. Because Peter Klaashorst is not only an exciting painter as the painter K, but also an exciting painter who acts, unwillingly, as a partner in crime with Zuckerberg. As the double-headed non-person, KZ, he is also a kind of non-person. When he, as PK, thinks he transforms the world in analogy of his own personal vision, that is, in succeeding to reflect the dark sides of this planet, his MZ side changes the conditions of this into a never-ending party feast. And to be more transparent, the ambiguous character of the faces, the sexual organs, the nude bodies that the artistic imagination and consciousness that the PK part of this artistic machine generate, are being disarmed and totally cleaned and hyper-washed by the weapons of the MZ whitewash machine. Or is it? But perhaps it is not such a good idea to talk about the Facebook paint ambition of this MK, or PZ. Let's try it another way. Just follow the normal opinion and agree that Facebook as the new medium is an important vehicle for his artistic ambition. Be happy with his Facebook catalog. But even then, we have to be careful. Not so long ago, for the information on a show in Phnom Penh, Cambodia, with the portraits of the victims of the Red Khmer regime in the school in Phnom Penh, Peter Klaashorst used a small catalog to publish the work. The photographs of these faces he used were the only reminiscence of many of them. These were the last proof of their life, these photos made by an official photographer before they were executed. This incredible booklet is difficult to look at, it makes you feel so uncomfortable. But in fact, it is also a Facebook. But it is a Facebook from hell. And then, I already commented on it, in the catalog of this show, there is also the relation between the portraits of these victims and the whole idea of a Facebook. As we know, the term Facebook is a continuation of a term from the American college culture, and it is for me a horrifying reflection of a dark episode of USA colonization. At least, my first contact with a Facebook was when many of the American death in the Vietnam War had only one official portrait, and that was from their college Facebook. Sinister to say, my first contact with the term Facebook was in relation to the American death portraits. And of course, when writing this text for Peter Klaashorst about his paintings of the faces of Red Khmer terror, I started to feel uncomfortable about another Facebook that I could not find. Nowhere, I mean, a Facebook of the killed Viet Cong soldiers. Where were the names of the death on their side? Where could I find their faces? Or did they die anonymously, only to be counted in a multiple string of numbers? By the way, isn't time now for Peter Klaashorst to repair this omission and try to find the right portraits of these forgotten soldiers? To start a campaign with his colleagues all over the world, so they will make a series of portraits of these 1 in a million unknown Viet Cong dead. And of course, now with these paintings shown in Amsterdam, no on internet anymore, is this still a double show of Peter Klaashorst and Zuckerberg? Yes, and no, yes, it's so real, but no, we cannot go for the minimized qualities of the internet work. Now, it is a challenge for our eyes to forget these internet interventions. That is, we have to forget Facebook, but also the routines we are used to in this sphere. Because, the Facebook Peter Klaashorst is much more digital internet style than the reality of these works. Perhaps, the best way to prepare yourself for this reality show is to study all the details of paintings of Rembrandt Velázquez or Rubens in the Google Museum of Older Art. With the impressions of this alternative for both Facebook and the Frankfurt reality still glowing in our eyes, Peter Klaashorst's real paintings are ready for inspection. The strokes of his brush related to the digital strokes of Rembrandt Google, or Velázquez Google. Which of their secret qualities are the most convincing, which one's the easiest to imitate? Take your time.
see you. We have some business. Need your attention.
Brace yourself. Send in one cardboard.
Don't do that. Come to the porch. I'd invite you. I have to shoot the dog. It's a slow draw you got there. Sure you want to do that? Shoot a dog in this cabin and bury you.